Okay, so just yesterday, Risk of Rain 2 had an update on Steam, and shortly after this update, the patch notes were released. The patch features gameplay changes, bug fixes, and quality of life improvements. And honestly, there's a ton of stuff here, so it's going to take a while to go over. I do apologize for that, because we are literally just going to run through every single thing that's changed. Now, before we get into it, there were also notes for a hotfix that some of you may or may not have noticed, and it's definitely worth mentioning. I never really noticed this bug happening to me, but I'm sure it had. But enemies that were executed from freezing weren't triggering the correct events to occur. This was leading to no on-kill money or procs, and even worse than that, if a player happened to execute the teleporter boss by freezing them, it could actually lock out the teleporter event from being completed. I definitely did not experience this one for myself, and my interpretation of what they mean here may be a little bit off, but regardless, this sounds pretty sucky. With that being said though, that is the only change in the hotfix patch mentioned in the notes, but it's obviously still a pretty big deal to have that fixed. Now, without much further delay, we've got to jump into the mega patch, which includes over 50 changes to things in the game. This includes enemies, mechanics, items, classes, bug fixes, quality of life changes. There's just an absolute ton going on here. Again, we're going to run through each and every change. I'm going to try keeping this as simple and straightforward as possible, and we're just going to go right through everything. Just like the patch notes, we are going to start on gameplay changes. First up, we have changes made to the fire elites in the game. This section is a pretty big deal because burn damage seemed to be one of the most powerful forces in the game, and that has now been addressed. I also forgot to mention, you guys, that some of these things that changed were community suggestions, and in the patch notes it is included whether or not that one of the changes is based on a community suggestion. So just as a simple code that we can all follow, I will include an asterisk next to the items or changes that were community suggestions. Okay, I swear, now we're starting. So the first gameplay changes that were based on community suggestions are to do with burning calculation and burning damage altogether. Since the update, players are able to see how many stacks of burning they have on their player at any given time. Burning damage does stack, which is important to know, and even more important in the heat of the moment is to know how many stacks of burning you have on yourself. They state that burning damage is now capped at taking 5% of your health a second per stack. This still seems like a lot to me, because if you've simply got 5 stacks of burning, you're losing a quarter of your health bar per second. They do actually mention though that this is a nerf to burn damage on a player, and although that's where burning damage is capped on players per stack, it will apparently always be hitting for less than that. Burn damage will also be ticking at twice the frequency, or just happening twice as often when a player has burn damage applied to them, but still resulting in the same overall damage. This seems intended to make the burn effects or burn stacks wear off a little bit quicker than they previously did. This new burn damage model is what will be used for the Magma Worm's burn damage attacks, and it will also be used for the Elder Lemurian's fire breath. I'm just going to quote this entire bit here, since it seems like something the devs want you to know and understand directly. The intent here is to make it clear to the player exactly what a burn does regardless of how it's applied. Players never were told by the game that burning actually stacks. If you have a certain number of burn stacks, you will now be aware of exactly how much that will hit for. Overall, this should make the burns way less bursty and way more consistent, also allowing heal over time effects to help counteract the damage. The intent is not to make the entire game easier or to make burns never kill you. Fire elites are the only purely offensive elite type, so they should be causing deaths. It should just feel like less BS now. I do want to mention that I did have a couple Magma Worm fights after this update, and the fights felt really great and manageable versus what they once were. Okay, we've got way more to cover. I've got to speed this up. Next up, we've got changes made to the Ice Elites, and here they focused on reworking the Ice Bomb. This one here is worded awkwardly, but they said improve graphics for Ice Bomb left when killed to be more clear. Ice Bomb damage reduced from 350% to 150%, which is a massive change. Ice Bomb damage would previously be reduced if you were at the radius of the explosion, and that no longer happens. Ice Bomb now freezes characters in the radius for 1.5 seconds. Now, this one happened to me a bunch yesterday. It was weird to get used to, but once you get the hang of it, it's actually kind of fun to work with. I feel like the freeze effect from Ice Bomb will be most annoying for low mobility classes. Again, I'm going to read this next segment straight from the developers themselves, because again, it seems like a straight from them to you sort of thing. Fire elites have always been the most threatening type, with the other two being pretty easy. The hope here is that after the nerf of the fire affix, the ice affix can now also be respected as a serious threat. The improved visuals should help clarify what the ice affix actually does. Most players don't seem to notice it drops a bomb at all. We're starting with a low freeze duration to test how it feels. I can say pretty confidently now that the ice bomb is very noticeable. I do think what they came up with here is really solid, and gameplay wise it works really well. Okay, now on to the lightning elites, which didn't didn't have many changes, but still had changes nonetheless. The lightning bombs from the lightning elites will now properly attach to players. Now, this is another one of the issues that I didn't even realize was an issue in the first place, and I didn't notice much a difference when playing after the update yesterday, but it still definitely seems like an appropriate change. The lightning elites now always spawn at full shields, and finally they improved the lightning bomb graphics. Okay, this next one is really awesome. I know a lot of us have been waiting for this. We have changes for the magma worm fight. The magma worm will now switch between two different modes of movement. He's got his leaping mode, which I think we're familiar with, where he goes really high in the air, and then when he hits the ground, he releases fireballs everywhere. And he's got a new grounded mode where he just slithers around on the ground really fast. I didn't even really notice the grounded mode very much when I played, but I only fought about 5 or 6 magma worms. I was also flying around as the huntress too, so I was mainly waiting in the air for attacks anyway. And another straight quote from the developers, "The intent is to give a break from the worm's constant leaping and to give short-range characters a chance to attack. The worm should also be an intense fight, not a slog." And the final two bits of the worm fight, they reduced armor from 20 to 15 to make it less tanky, and the worm can now jump off platforms so it doesn't get stuck on certain ledges. Again, I fought the worm a handful of times after yesterday's update, and I really like its current state versus its previous. Next up, we've got a pretty good change for when players sacrifice themselves at the obelisk, since it will now give all players who are sacrificed 5 lunar coins. It is stated, people want a legit way to get more lunar coins, and there's currently no purpose on obliterating past the first time. This should help alleviate both. I think this is a pretty nice and thoughtful change, and I did actually throw out a really, really great run yesterday in order to get some coins. Next up, we've got a change made to the Hellfire Tincture, which is an equipment item that I think is my least favorite in the game. This is the one that deals damage to you and all enemies within a certain radius. They've buffed it up a little bit, increasing the radius from 6 meters to 9 meters, so for those of you that may be on the fence about running this equipment item sometimes, this might make a difference for you. And now on to a few enemy type changes. First up, we've got the Stone Titan. The Stone Titan had his laser's proc coefficient reduced from 1 to 0.15. That's obviously a pretty massive drop, and it is said that it primarily affects the duration of burning effects, which I'm guessing means that the proc effect on his laser was to apply burning. The Hermit Crab had its proc coefficient for its mortar attack reduced from 3 to 0.5, another pretty massive drop, and this time again is said to primarily affect the duration of burning effects. On top of that, the Hermit Crab also had its base health reduced from 150 down to 100. And finally, we have a small adjustment for the Imp, who had its base health reduced from 250 down to 200. Overall, some pretty simple changes, and it's unclear how these will affect gameplay, but these changes should really add up when you consider going up against hordes of these enemies at a time. Okay, now we're on to one of my favorite parts of this update, changes for the Artificer, Huntress, Mercenary, and Commando. First up, we've got changes for the Artificer, who had her proc coefficient on Flame Bolt increase from 0.2 to 1. The Artificer also had her proc coefficient on the Snap Freeze Pillars increased from 0 to 1, and the Pillar's explosion radius was also increased from 1.5 meters to 2.5 meters. I haven't played enough of the Mage to know, but I guess there was an issue where not all enemies who triggered these freeze pillars would actually freeze. The radius increase should resolve this issue. They also mentioned, just like they previously had, that the Artificer mistakenly had very low proc coefficients. It's easy to tell from the big changes, 0.2 to 1 and 0 to 1, that they weren't kidding here. We've also got one simple Huntress change. The proc coefficient on her Arrow Rain attack was increased from 0.1 to 0.2. Because we're talking decimal numbers here, it doesn't sound like a lot, but this is literally double the proc coefficient that it was. They said Arrow Rain had a very low proc coefficient because of its AoE damage over time status, but it was unnecessarily low. I never really played too much Huntress until yesterday, and now I think she's my favorite in the game. I don't really think this is based on the changes that they made to her, I just think she's awesome. The Mercenary had an interesting change where they extended the timeout duration of his Blinding Assault ability from 2 seconds to 3 seconds. For those of you that don't know, Blinding Assault is a mercenary ability where he's able to lunge and attack an enemy. If he connects with an enemy, he can recast the ability, up to 3 total times. While this does sound like a nerf to his ability, they actually made it a quality of life change as well, and now Mercenary can cast other abilities in between recasting his Shift ability without initiating the cooldown on it. And finally, on to the Commando. They said they improved the FMJ impact graphics. I'm not really sure whether or not this is referring to a particular attack, and I only played as him for about 15 or 20 minutes yesterday and didn't really notice much different. If you guys can help me out with this one in the comments below, it would be greatly appreciated. Okay, we're actually pretty far down the list of changes now, and before we jump into bug fixes, we do actually have a miscellaneous section to get to. The game time will now pause at in-between stages like the Hidden Realms and whatnot. When you first spawn into a level, you will have 3 3 seconds of invincibility, and now numbers on the scoreboard will have proper formatting to them. So a bunch of simple stuff, but a bunch of good stuff. Okay, since we've got about 30 bug fixes to list, in order to save time, I'm simply going to list each and every bug fix. So bear with me here because it's a lot. Fixed a major issue with pre-placed network objects. This issue was especially frequent for clients with better performance specs than their host. This should fix at least the following bugs. Map assets, which are portals, shop contents, and teleporters, will no longer sometimes be missing for clients. Clients will no longer be stuck in the pod when entering a stage. Clients will no longer be stuck in mid-air when entering a stage. Clients will no longer be unable to select a character if joining from one networked session to another. And clients will no longer be missing out-of-bound zones, which caused them to fall forever. Allow changes in maximum health slash shield to instantly fill that missing amount. This means that the Wake of Vultures and Transcendence will no longer give you an empty shield. Improve spawn logic to reduce chances of spawning through the floor. Clean up engineers' turret skill drivers to fix their AI not working sometimes. Multi's secondary equipment will no longer inherit the cooldown of the first when picking up equipment off the floor. Improved collision detection of Hellfire Aura. Updating elite naming for localization and appearance in pings. Prevent pre-placed map objects spawning into dynamically spawned ones. Clean up save procedures to reduce chance of save corruption. Names for reconnected players will now appear correctly instead of being question marks. Bloom can now be turned off in the settings. Frozen material overlay now properly always displays. Update Huntress strafing animation to blend properly. Fix incorrect normal textures. Add missing jump animation. Fix Artificer's snap freeze explosion radius not being large enough to always freeze enemies who trigger it. Fix AI sometimes considering itself as a target for friendly searches. Fix the engineer sometimes being able to get more than two turrets. Fix the mercenary being able to take major fall damage during dash attacks. Remove a typo in the engineer description. Fix slider value text scrolling past the mask in the options menu. Imp overlords no longer blink off into the distance if no viable target is found. Brass contraption bodies can no longer be targeted by clients. Radar scanner now properly identifies teleporters and barrels. Correct some typos. Reducing screen shake no longer reduces controller vibrations. Controller vibration no longer persists into the main menu after quitting a run. Okay, I think that was everything. Obviously a tremendous list of bug fixes. I am sorry for doing it that way, but most of them are very straightforward and I didn't feel like taking another 10 minutes of your guys' time to go over them. But again, that is not it for this patch or the patch notes here, as we do also have a few quality of life improvements. They said they reduced the particle system noise quality to improve performance, and this may be entirely in my head, but it seems like overall after the update, performance is slightly better. They now allow use of the pause menu in the character selection screen. And finally, they slightly increased the bloom threshold in Abyssal Depths to be less glowy. It's not something that ever really bothered me previously, but again, another nice change. I know that this was a patch and not necessarily a content update, but for the size and scale of the game, this was a massive, massive patch. It seems like over and over again, I cannot get over how tremendously well they are doing with this game. And I hope you guys are still happy with the team, happy with the game, and happy with the way things are going. I'm also sorry that this video ended up being as long as it did. I kind of wanted to make this a shorter one, but again, there was just a ton of stuff here and there wasn't really anything that was worth skipping over. I also was planning to do more things than just list changes for you guys, but that's about all we've done thus far and we're almost 14 minutes into the video. So I'm sorry that this was kind of a blah video just listing changes, but thank you guys an absolute ton for watching and watching as much of it as you did. If you guys do want to support the channel, the standard stuff does work the best. Leave a like on the video, subscribe with notifications if you have not already, leave a comment behind, and mainly just show up for future content on the channel. But again, this video is already way too long. Thank you guys so much for watching it. I hope to see you in a future one.